Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the European and External Relations Committee in session five. Can I remind members and members of the public in the gallery to turn off their mobile phones and other electronic devices or put them to silent as they can interfere with the sound systems. Today we have received apologies from our members Tavish Scott, Richard Lockhead and Jackson Carlow. However, I'd like to welcome Mr. Mike Rumbles to the meeting, and Mr. Rumbles is welcome to take part in the meeting if he chooses after the committee members have asked their questions of witnesses. The first decision that we are making is whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Item 4 is a review of the evidence heard. Item 5 is consideration of the posts of advisor to the committee. And item 6 is consideration of the committee's call for written evidence. Are we agreed to take these items in private?
Agreed.
Thank you. Now, item 2 on the agenda is the implications to Scotland of Brexit, in particular the economic implications. I welcome to the meeting Dr. Graham Roy, Director Designate of the Fraser of Allender Institute, Colin Borland, Senior Head of External Affairs at the Federation of Small Business in Scotland, Kerry Richmond, Senior Director of Scottish Enterprise, and Stephen Boyd, Assistant Secretary to the STUC. Members will have seen that Dr. Roy, has kindly provided some additional materials to the committee. So, although we don't have a lot of time for introductory remarks, I would like to give Dr. Roy the opportunity to outline some of his findings before we enter into our general discussion. Thanks very much, Dr. Roy.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I thought it would just be quite helpful to run through quite quickly, from an economics perspective, the kind of key issues that Brexit throws up for the Scottish economy. And without saying in a positive or negative way, but just the types of issues that need to be resolved over the next wee while and what will be driving the impacts that people like us are saying are likely on the economy. So I've kind of grouped these into long-term and short-term effects. I guess in the terms of the long-term, there's probably five key issues that the committee would potentially want to think about. The first thing is the trading relationships that are thrown up by the decision to leave the European Union. So obviously, within the European Union is a single market. Moving away from that means that a new trading relationship will have to be designed. And with 40%, just over 40% of Scottish exports going into the European Union, that's obviously quite an important fact and an important result that needs to be taken care of. Within there's lots of different models that you could design for having these new trading relationships. So you've heard of being a member of the European Economic Area, so the Norway-type model. There's obviously the Swiss-type model, which is more on bilateral arrangements. And then there's more alternative versions around free trade areas and moving completely into the World Trade Organization point, where you're just operating as a country with normal tariff barriers. So that's the first set of issues. The second set of issues concern the implications for investment. Scotland has been quite a successful area within the UK for attracting international investment. A large part of that has been because of the skills and wider infrastructure of the Scottish economy. But we know that one of the reasons why international investors come to the UK and come to Scotland is access to the single market. So there's a set of issues there. Third set of issues really concern population and the labour market. So Scotland, over the last few years, has had net migration coming in from different parts of the European Union. The European Union has also been quite strong in putting forward regulations, both in the labour market but also the product market. By moving out of the side of the European Union, obviously these issues now need to be resolved and thought about. Fourth issue is really the fiscal contributions. So there's obviously quite a lot of debate in the referendum about what the net contribution was of the United Kingdom to the European Union and the difference between gross and net contributions. So the gross contributions are the total amount that is paid into the EU, but then once you take off things like the rebate and also the other revenues that come into the UK and Scotland through the research funding and CAP and all these various other elements, then there's a set of issues there that need to be considered around what the potential fiscal implications of leaving the EU would be. And I guess then the final issue is probably the ones that the economists are a bit more interested in and a bit more concerned about, are what we'd call the dynamic effects. So we know that companies that export, we know that inward investment tends to have a positive impact on things like productivity and on skills. And if our exports and investment were to change over time, then that could have implications for things like productivity and things like our overall growth rate and competition. So there's a set of issues in there which might be quite significant over the long term. So on balance, most independent economists would view that leaving the EU in the long run would tend to have a negative impact on output and jobs, holding all else remaining equal. So there's obviously policy choices that could also flow from that that might change all of that. The thing that's probably more uncertain and a bit more complex is what might happen in the short run. And we've got some forecasts out this morning which try and estimate what we think will happen to the Scottish economy over the next 3 years. And really that comes down to kind of two key issues that I would see. One is the impact of uncertainty on the economy. We know that in an uncertain world, investors and businesses tend to put off decisions. In the short run, that can be largely temporary, so that when the clarity comes in, then you start investing again. So the impact is largely short term and you get a bounce back. But the longer that uncertainty goes on for, the more likely that decisions to postpone investment turn into cancellation and changes in plan. There's also policy uncertainty in there. We don't yet know what the end result will be from the negotiations. So we don't know whether we'll have access to the single market or whether we'll be outside the single market. So that injects another element of uncertainty into the mix, which has implications for how businesses will respond. And we also know that financial markets have been volatile and will likely continue to be volatile as the negotiations go forward. And that in itself can have an impact on business decisions. It's more likely that risk premium will be added to borrowing costs as people factor in potential volatility and uncertainty. And the final thing is really that, you know, linking back to the long-term adjustments, is that over time people will start to make decisions about what the relationship will be with their trading partners in the EU, and we would expect that businesses will start to gradually change their decisions and change their investments. And on balance, we think that in the short term that will have a negative impact on Scottish growth over the next 3 years. This morning we've revised down our forecasts for each of the next 3 years. I would caution that by saying that we also believe that it's quite different from like the financial crisis, so we're not predicting an immediate long recession. All we're really predicting is a period of relatively slow, flat growth while we adjust to the new relationships.
Well, thank you very much for that. Yeah, certainly your material this morning certainly makes quite grim reading for Scotland. A number of the members of the committee recently returned from Brussels, and the message there was very much that access to the single market is very different from a free trade arrangement, which is why most businesses and inward investors want access to the single market. Do you think there's a lack of understanding that access to the single market is not the same thing as a free trade arrangement?
I think there are really quite significant and important differences between single market and a free trade area. So essentially a free trade area gives you, removes tariffs between the two trading partners, particularly in goods. What it doesn't give you is access largely through services. So even within Switzerland, for example, while there have a special bilateral relationship between Switzerland and in the EU, that doesn't exist in services. So Swiss financial services companies have to incorporate separate bodies within the European Union in order to trade as entities within the EU. So all the free trade area really does is remove tariffs. What it doesn't do is remove the tariffs larger than services. It also doesn't remove non-tariff barriers. So one of the things that a single market does that's really important is means that somebody producing a good in the UK or in Scotland, provided that they satisfy the regulations that are common across the European Union, then they can just sell that market easily into the rest of the EU. A free trade area doesn't guarantee that, because you've got to then comply with all the various regulations that go on in there. And I guess the third point that is also quite important, even the difference between a single market and the European Economic Area, is that the European Economic Area requires you to have proof of origin rules to ensure that a good that's produced in the European Economic Area is actually produced in that area, and it's not a good that's essentially come from another country, bypassed into somewhere like Norway, and then, you know, traded into the European Union. And that means that all goods that are outside the single market essentially have to go through a process of proving that they have been produced in that country in order to be traded into there. And that adds, you know, a small cost of, say, 1-2% onto trading. And when you're looking at tight margins, adding in things like proof of origin, non-tariff costs, and other compliance issues, before you even get to tariffs, then there is quite a significant difference between something like a free trade area and a single market.
And of course, it's not possible to have the single market without having free movement of labour, and that was what came across very loud and clear during our visit to Brussels as well. Do you think that there's any evidence in terms of your forecast for the Scottish economy? Is there any suggestion that perhaps Scotland could be more sharply hit? We've received evidence showing that, for example, European-owned businesses make up a larger proportion of the Scottish economy. We already know that foreign direct investment is higher in Scotland, and you've outlined how there's a big threat to foreign direct investment. Do you think there are particular aspects of the Scottish economy which make us more vulnerable? And it'd be interesting to hear other panellists' views on that.
I think at this stage, I think we would say it's too early to say whether Scotland will be relatively more impacted than the rest of the UK. Obviously, within there, the different sectoral makeup of the Scottish economy could mean that you'll have different results. There's obviously a big issue for the UK about the City of London and the importance of passporting rights, which have a disproportionate effect there. The one thing I would say is that one of the things that Scotland has always struggled with relative to other parts of the UK has been its gap in productivity performance, and that's narrowed in recent years. But Scottish productivity has tended to lag the rest of the UK, even despite closing recently. But we know there is strong evidence between exports, inward investment, and productivity. So if our inward investment and exports were to shrink further as a result of leaving the European Union, that makes the ability to improve our productivity that much more difficult. So from a macro perspective, I would say that's probably one of the biggest risks that comes to this, is what's the long-term impact on Scotland's productivity. We know that that is a reason why our performance has differed from the UK in the past, and we know that's also why the UK's economic performance has lagged many other countries within the European Union, because of a lack of productivity. So I would say that's probably a key concern and a key issue for us to consider.
Does anyone else want to come in on that?
Well, we've spoken to a lot of companies, a lot of our customers over the last few weeks, and encouragingly, very few are stating that they're putting investment plans on hold or R&D plans on hold. I think that reflects Fraser Allender's business survey as well, which was suggesting that at the moment, very few companies are stopping doing things, which I think is encouraging. And also, I guess in terms of inward investment, I'm sure you're aware from the statistics, Scotland does very well within the UK, and I think that's because of our assets, like our people, our skills, our research base. So we've got lots of assets to continue to build on in terms of inward investment.
Can I bring in Lewis MacDonald now?
Thanks very much. And going back to some of Graham Roy's evidence, but more widely for other members of the panel as well, the differences between membership of the European Economic Area or access to single market on the one hand and free trade agreements on the other hand, I think you've explained very succinctly. Clearly, the other big question in front of us and in front of government is, what is the difference between membership of the European Union and membership of the single market? And given this Parliament's intent to retain the benefits of the relationships we have with the European Union, including access to the single market, I wonder if members of the panel would comment on how far those benefits would be protected in the event that Scotland or the UK remained fully engaged with the single market, even without membership of the European Union?
From an economic perspective, the membership of the single market, we've said in our report today, we think is key. I think the issue is, which strays less into my territory, is how you can retain access to the single market without being a member of the EU. And that obviously is, I guess, is one of the big things that needs to be resolved and dealt with. As I said, you know, the European Economic Area, retains quite a lot of access to the single market. But one of the big things in there, by not being a member of the EU, you don't get an opportunity to shape the rules and regulations that govern the single market. So Norway doesn't have an opportunity to input into the single market process for all the rules and regulations that go on in that. I think that's probably quite an important policy difference between being a member of the EU and having access to the single market.
And in terms of the benefits for business, and particularly I'm thinking of also labour rights and human rights, many of which I think are delivered within EEA countries like Norway as part of the single market arrangements, how far do those rights require membership of the EU as opposed to membership of the single market in order to be protected? I wonder if Stephen Boyd and Colin Barlow might have views on those.
I agree absolutely with Graham's analysis up until now, and I think there are clearly a couple of major unknowns, timing of Article 50 and what the UK government's preferred approach is going to be. And I think within that context, I mean, it's very difficult. I mean, I think it's important we're clear that we're kind of looking at least bad scenarios here. I mean, whatever we're likely to end up with is likely to be significantly worse than what we had before as full membership of the EU. Now, the extent to which labour rights would be protected by EEA status, I guess, depends on that particular deal negotiated, but they're very unlikely to be strengthened by that process. And I think given who's likely to be doing the negotiating on behalf of the UK, there is a risk that it could be diminished in some way, shape or form. Now, clearly, you know, as I say, we're looking at least bad scenarios, and EEA status would offer a degree of protection that's not going to be there under other scenarios, but you know, I think it's important to emphasise that, you know, whatever we end up with is likely to be worse than what we have under full membership.
Yeah, I think, you know, in terms of what we've said as immediate priorities, simple access to the European single market has been the top one, and allied to that is we need to retain the ability of businesses to hire the right people for the job. You know, we have a £9.7 billion annual tourism industry in Scotland, which relies on seasonal migrant labour. We also had, as the convener said, a substantial non-UK EU citizen entrepreneur community in Scotland who we would be very concerned about them leaving. So I guess, as other panellists have said, it will depend entirely on what sort of deal is struck where we end up. But those are the two things that we are very clear have to be prioritised in those negotiations. Turning to your point specifically about sort of rights and regulations, I think, again, clarity in the regulatory framework has to be a priority. And while, of course, nothing will change on day one, because a lot of this law, particularly around about employment, is incorporated into UK law anyway, but when that law begins to, you know, can be changed by a UK government, or indeed will be interpreted by the UK Supreme Court as opposed to the ECJ, then there is, of course, the scope for divergence. Now, again, depends on what sort of deal is done, whether or not those businesses who only trade within the UK or indeed within Scotland have to be subject to the same rules, or it's just those who are selling into that single market. Again, remains to be seen, but there's certainly the potential there for some quite interesting practical issues to be thrown up if we begin to diverge.
And coming back to Graham Roy and the differences in, and I guess focusing specifically on the issues of trade, you mentioned the long-term challenges around trade and foreign direct investment. In those two areas particularly, does membership of the single market deliver the level of benefits that we have at the moment, or something close to them, or is what is lost more significant in terms of those two particular areas?
I think it's probably, think about it on a sliding scale, that the closer you are to being able to retain and remain in the single market, then the less the impact will be in trade and investment, because by having no tariff barriers, no non-tariff barriers, by meeting all the various regulations, then the difference between that sort of arrangement, if it can be secured, and the current arrangement is actually relatively small. The question is whether that can you can be delivered. But as you start to move away into membership of the EEA, for example, that's when you have to have proof of origin rights. So that means that you have customs duty, not custom duties, but custom checks between EEA members and the European Union. When you then move into the Swiss model, that doesn't give you access to the services of the single market. When you then move into the model with Turkey, you then don't have any access really to services at all. You then move into something like free trade, which gives you no tariff barriers, but it doesn't give you full access to the single market. And if you come out completely into just a WTO type model, then you have tariff barriers. So I think it's worth thinking about it in that terms of scale.
If you're a Japanese or North American or Chinese investor and you're making an investment decision, what signal from the UK government about its negotiating position would be most likely to encourage you to consider investing in the UK?
Yeah. For me, it's access to single market. That's by far the biggest, by far the biggest, most important factor.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. I think Bruce Crawford has a supplementary on that point.
On that single market issue, if that's the most preferential position for Scotland to be in, how do we best achieve that? Because otherwise we're back to the least bad.
Mm.
So how can we best achieve that?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess from my point of view, I guess it's about where you can position yourself onto that scale, and that will come down to the negotiations that take place between the UK and the EU, but also then the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament's input into that process. But how that then happens, I guess, is ultimately up to policymakers and the politicians behind it. But I would say that the central thing that has to be in that is pressing for as close as possible access to the single market, whether that be along that scale, where that ultimately ends up. The closer you can get that to the single market, the better.
Steve?
Yeah, I mean, we're now firmly in the realm of politics, I think, rather than economics. But, I mean, I think it's important to remind ourselves about what seemed to work for the Leave campaign during the referendum campaign itself. I mean, the two things they consistently came back to were the UK's financial contribution to the EU and the free movement of people. Now, it's very difficult, I think, at this moment in time to envisage any circumstances by which the EU would give the UK full access to the single market without retaining both free movement and a very significant financial contribution to the EU. So, indeed, if you look at some of the analysis published last week by the Bruegel think tank, it shows that countries in the EEA area currently both pay a higher proportion in terms of GDP as a financial contribution, and also take a higher level of migrant workers as a proportion of the whole workforce than the UK currently does. So it's difficult to see how these conditions can be satisfied in a politically acceptable way in the post-Brexit world.
Yeah, I recognise the reason I asked that question was to get to the least bad position, actually, because if we are in the least bad position, I'd wonder how realistic it is that they will be able to access some sort of EEA agreement, and how widely known and how widely understood is it within the industry and the economy in Scotland that every single member of the European Union would need to sign up to that European Economic Agreement, and it would also include probably Norway and Sweden having to sign up, sorry, Norway and Iceland having to sign up to that too. So how widely known is that, do you think, in business circles, that that's actually the mechanism that would be required to be gone through? And how realistic is it that that would be achievable?
Yeah, I mean, I can't comment on how realistic it is in terms of the level of understanding that there is around about some of the mechanics of this. I think it's fair to say it's sketchy. And it is a matter of regret that we didn't get the opportunity to tease out some of these issues and talk about them in a bit more detail during the campaign. Indeed, I was casting my mind back. I think I spent more time talking about the practical implications of membership of the EU or not during the 2014 independence referendum. And that's where we were going back to look stuff up when we were receiving inquiries about this. So I think, yeah, it's a matter of regret that we're only now getting down to that sort of very practical brass tacks discussion, and that it didn't take place before the vote. But unfortunately, you know, we are where we are and we've got to deal with it.
Can I just come in on that point? Colin Borland, the EFTA EEA agreement, as has already been touched on, doesn't actually give you access to the customs union. So in terms of the debate, such as it was that we had during the referendum, where the Brexit side were talking about the bureaucracy of the EU, it seems to me that the EFTA EE agreement or any alternative will actually bring more bureaucracy and complication for small and medium-sized businesses than the EU currently does.
Yeah, that's certainly a risk. I mean, I meant, again, in a different context, and I suppose the debate's academic now, but when we were talking about TTIP and we were discussing some of the issues with the US negotiators there about how you, for example, if you're a whiskey exporter, how you get into the US market and the number of hurdles and extra things you have to get through, and also people very simply, you know, just getting stock and products through through customs, then yes, you know, whenever you add in something extra, then there's the potential for that to go, you know, to add, you know, an extra bureaucratic burden. And I mean, indeed, the other thing, we're talking about free movement of people. Of course, it's possible to hire people from outside of the EU, but again, there's a fairly lengthy, complex process to go through to do that, and hiring people from the EU, it's fairly straightforward. So we would need to get something in place in the UK that would allow that sort of movement of goods and of labour with the absolute minimum of extra bureaucracy, if that's where we end up, depending on the deal, obviously, and whatever we end up finally signing up to. Mm.
And yet the only bespoke arrangement that currently really exists is for Switzerland, and they have about 120 different bilateral deals with the EU. That sounds pretty bureaucratic, doesn't it?
And Graham made the point, I think, about, you know, that doesn't include the service sector.
Yes.
And I think that Leonard colleagues will correct me if I'm incorrect, but I think that's something like 80% of the Scottish economy. Mm. So it's, you know, that is significant. Whether we like it or not, we're a service-based economy. And I think that's something else that we need to take into account.
Would other members like to come in at this point?
Not everybody managed to reflect on the question asked there, John.
Does someone else want?
I think I saw Graham.
I mean, your point about, you know, what's the understanding in all of this? I guess one kind of anecdotal thing which we found quite surprising from our business survey was when we asked, had your firm done any preparation for the UK exiting the EU? And we found that 85% had done very little or no preparation whatsoever. And starts to fit into your question about what's the level of understanding going in. It's now businesses are beginning to react and think about things like the different models that, if you know, your point being exactly correct as well about being in EFTA, the EEA, you're not part of the customs union. So that concept of proof of origin is really important. And just to be clear about what that means that everybody who's exporting from within the EEA or EFTA to the European Union has to prove that the good has been produced in that country and is not been produced or supported by, you know, a third country. So, you know, imports from China or something like that. And that costs money. It means that every small business, every medium-sized business has to go through a process of proving that the good is locally produced, and that costs money, and you don't have that when you're in the single market.
Stephen Burke?
Yeah, there's a few things I'd like to come back in now, but back to the point about the level of understanding, and I think within the trade union movement, it's certainly deeper than it was 6 months ago, but I think it's probably not great. But I think that you know, brings us on to a much wider point about the huge, glaring lack of capacity there is at all levels, I think, to deal with complex issues of trade across the UK. Now, we've seen much written about the yawning chasm that there is in Westminster at the moment, and I think that's inevitable, given there's been no responsibility over these issues for about 40 years. But I think it goes much deeper than that, right across all institutions in the UK that have an interest, I think, in economic matters. Trade has been under-discussed for an awful long time, and I think it's only now that people are really beginning to think about the deeper issues involved here. And up until now, we've been discussing what our relationship with the EU is going to be like. When you think about how we've relied on the EU to negotiate free trade agreements with over 50 other countries, I mean, our capacity for doing that, the UK's capacity for negotiating these, Scotland's capacity to monitor these in our interest, I think is a real problem and one that I think we have to recognise. If I just quickly come back to the bureaucracy point, because I think it's really important. I think during the Brexit campaign, we all paid the price, I think, for the actions of a number of organisations over a prolonged period of time, exaggerating and distorting the issue of EU red tape, which I think is always been massively exaggerated. I've sat in the Scottish Government's regulatory review group for over 10 years now. Rarely have we ever seen a genuine problem of EU regulations that have not been easily dealt with at Scottish level. And very often you get down to the detail of these things, there's no problem at all. And I think the convener's absolutely right to raise the point that, you know, if the UK now is to access the single market in any kind of effective way, then bureaucracy is going to increase significantly. And I think Graeme mentioned the rules of origin. I think he's outlined that problem very well. I was reading some stuff last night, you know, and suggests that it's really not just a problem for small and medium-sized businesses. Given the length and complexity of global supply chains now, even large organisations in Scotland will, you know, struggle to meet the rules of origin requirements are likely to be introduced if indeed we do access the single market in the future.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, just on the lack of understanding, I think that probably is a factor for a number of companies, and feedback we've been asking companies how we can help or what assistance we can provide. One of the most common responses has been just being able to provide the information of what's happening, what the implications are going forward. So we're looking at that as part of our services, to have that bank of information for companies that are looking forward.
Thank you very much. I think we have a question from Ashton Denham.
Good morning. You've talked, a number of you have mentioned the idea of uncertainty being, you know, quite a problem for businesses and also for the economy going forward. I just wonder if any of you have seen the Institute of Directors did a survey on businesses, and they asked them, you know, what would their optimal arrangement be going forward? And the majority of them, it's at 40%, said that they preferred bilateral free trade agreements, so that be like the one that's recently been agreed with Canada. I'm wondering how compatible the idea of, you know, ending uncertainty and the idea that these bilateral agreements can take such a long time to negotiate. I think the Canadian one has been about 7 years in the making. I mean, do businesses think about that? Are these two ideas compatible, that it could take such a long time in order to sort of resolve this?
I have to go first. I mean, I think, just, you know, talk about our survey that we did, you know, most companies came back to say that access to single market was, you know, was a highly important thing for them. So that's a slightly different result, but it's the kind of key result that being access to trade is the most important bit. I think the point that Stephen made, I think was quite right around that these bilateral arrangements are not easy to do. There's a large number of countries that you need to do. The EU already has 50 trade arrangements with countries at the moment, plus there's the 27 countries in the EU. So you've got to think about, you know, adding all of these up becomes very, very complex and very difficult. And the average length of time to negotiate these things, you know, are years. It's not something that tends to get done overnight, because it's not just about what's the impact on trade, but it's also issues about what's the distributional impacts on that, what's the impacts on sectors that you need to think carefully through. And I know that some people who, in the argument for Brexit, some of the economic models that were used to argue in favour of leaving the EU were also coming at the idea of essentially just doing away with tariff barriers entirely. And the implications, which I'm sure you'll hear for later, about that on things like the agricultural sector, of having no tariff barriers and what it would mean for manufacturing, et cetera, are actually quite massive. And you need to think carefully through what not just the macroeconomic impacts are of your different trade policies, but what are the distributional impacts. And there's obviously been quite a lot of controversy around things like TTIP and what that might mean for public services and so on. So negotiating all these trade deals take a long time, and I guess that's the point that we're making about the uncertainty effect kicks in, and back to the point about if you're a Japanese or an American investor looking in to invest somewhere in the European Union, comparing the UK with that uncertainty continuing for a while, or going into somewhere like Ireland or going somewhere into the rest of Europe, you know, it's something which puts us at a disadvantage.
Just very quickly on the point just about business, I don't think we're quite there yet. In a position where, I mean, we're very clear that the priority is access to European markets and others. We're not, and I don't think, in a position yet to say how we best think that should be achieved. We are going to be commissioning some work over the back end of the summer, beginning of the autumn, to look at the different options that are available and see if, you know, if one does stand out, then we can back it. But we're not quite, I mean, it's early days, just over a month in, so I wouldn't want to make any sort of definitive pronouncement on that just yet.
I don't think the nature of free trade agreements is well understood at all in business or beyond business, and there's assumption that free trade means free trade. Well, actually, these are massively complex agreements about managed trade, and it's about how we manage that trade in our interest that is the key issue. Now, I mean, if you take for an example what will be one of the most important free trade agreements would be the one that the UK negotiates with the US. Now, you need to understand what is motivating the US here and what they have their eyes on. And as we discussed, the last time was before the committee was to discuss our concerns around about TTIP. But when US trade agreements are negotiated at the behest of very well-organised, very well-funded US industrial lobbies, so they'll have their eyes on things like NHS procurement, which has been a very long-held aspiration for US pharmaceutical companies, for agriculture, etc. And when you have an extremely experienced, well-organised, well-funded US Office for Trade negotiating against an extremely inexperienced, naive UK lobby, which will probably be motivated by economic theory that doesn't really bear much relation to the reality of the world that we're living in, then it's very difficult to see how we don't get squeezed in that scenario.
And just thinking about uncertainty across as a whole, got to remember that most companies in Scotland don't export overseas, only about 10% do. So a lot of other companies are kind of thinking uncertainty in terms of the wider consumer confidence, et cetera. So we have to think about it in that terms too.
I need to bring in Rachel Hamilton, I believe.
It's very much on what Kenny Richmond just said there. Obviously, businesses are going through a very uncertain period at the moment. They're almost like as if they're in a holding pen. The situations we're talking about are very hypothetical, and there are no answers, clearly, at the moment. We know what we would like. We'd like access to the single market. And how that progresses is obviously a matter of time. There has been some positive news this morning about investment from pharmaceutical companies. McDonald's are employing, and there has been a slight uplift in growth. However, how are we going to prepare businesses to actually look for opportunities? You mentioned in your report that there could be opportunities, particularly through innovation, creativity. How are we going to prepare businesses, and what do we need to do to actually prepare them to move forward, even in this holding pen situation?
So there's lots of enterprising businesses in Scotland, and the evidence suggests, you know, those businesses that are looking at opportunities, investing in innovation, looking at markets outside Scotland. So the rest of the UK is potentially a huge market for businesses in Scotland. So I think it's a role for us all, for public sector business organisations, to really think about how can we raise the ambition of Scotland's businesses? How can we look at those businesses that are doing well and use them as good practice examples? Some businesses have said to us, with the change in the exchange rate, that their exports becoming more more competitive. So they're looking at that as an opportunity to perhaps increase exports. So I think there's a lot that we can do to help businesses look at their growth characteristics and support them with that.
I think it's important to put it in context that we need to remember that we're not starting off from a great place. I mean, even before the 23rd of June, the numbers, are particularly amongst the smallest businesses, weren't looking good. Confidence was falling, hiring intentions were weak, investment intentions were falling back, turnover was down, profits were squeezed, overheads were going up. It was a difficult situation. What we don't yet have is enough data for this quarter to know exactly where we've been. But I would preface the rest of these remarks with the fact that we're not starting off from a position of strength, particularly. Generally speaking, I think Kenny's right that businesses are entrepreneurial and they'll be out there and they'll be identifying the markets. So I was speaking to somebody who's in sort of high-end knitwear. A lot of customers in the US, the value of the pound has been really good for sales. Other people are thinking about how other people can maybe price jobs in US dollars, for example, are saying, well, I'm not going to go out of business, but that's my profit margin gone for this month. So people are spotting opportunities and adapting already, I think. That's certainly the anecdotal evidence. One thing we've suggested that I think could help, and I was really pleased that the Scottish Government has agreed to take it forward, is having some sort of central advice function provided by the Scottish Government, so that, because there's a lot of competing advice and a lot of competing forecasts out there, somewhere to go to say, I have this particular issue, can you tell me what I should do? If the answer is do nothing, because nothing's going to change for 5 years, smashing, but if I need to be thinking about it, I want that sort of advice now, and I think that would be really helpful. And what that would also do would be a sort of like an early warning station, almost like, it would be testing a weather station, it would be testing the temperature. So it could feed back up if there were particular problems in particular industries and sectors or types of business that really policymakers at the centre should be aware of or should be feeding back into the negotiating teams, then that would be a good sort of early warning system. So I think that's a good practical step that the Scottish Government can take and indeed is taking. Alongside that, it's the prescription for this, I suppose, or to make the best of the situation, is exactly as I would have been saying if it had been a yes vote. We need to think about how we tax businesses and do that fairly. We need to think about how we spend our money, spend it wisely, try and spend as much with smaller Scottish companies as we can, and we regulate sensibly.
I guess just widening that point out a bit, I think, it's always difficult when you have economic forecasters coming out with slightly gloomy news, but I think we do also have to, policymakers do have to, to have an important role in restoring confidence and actually, boosting that as much as possible. I think there's a danger that you get into a cycle of, everything's gloomy, as Kenny mentioned, not everybody exports, so they're actually more concerned about consumer confidence within the domestic economy. So we've got to, there's a role for government there to put out strong messages about Scotland and the UK being open for business, about, working to grow the economy. Within that, we also argue that there is probably a case now for some form of stimulus to the economy on the fiscal side of things. We know that the Bank of England are looking quite hard at what they might do over the next month or so around interest rates or quantitative easing. But we also see that given where we are, the balance would be is that there is, that there's an opportunity for some form of either infrastructure investment programme from the UK level or simple things like your point about looking at new opportunities and new markets. Well, how does policy encourage that? So what policy could you do to support exporters accessing new markets? What about access to finance for exporters to get involved in that? So I think that part of it is quite important. But again, while there's opportunities for business, there's also a wider question, I think, for policy as a whole, in that we know that issues around productivity and regional imbalances and structural imbalances have been there in the UK and Scottish economy before the decision to leave the European Union. So actually there's potentially an important role to think about, well, now what is the future of economic policy more broadly within this new world? So how do you go around boosting productivity in an economy that's now outside the European Union? What do we need to do around infrastructure? What do we need to do about skills? And I think that is where I think the debate needs to go into around restoring this confidence and the opportunities that will come in the future, which will undoubtedly be there.
Wanted to come into on that point?
Yeah, a couple of points, if you don't mind. I mean, I just think we need to tread carefully. Any bit of good economic news we hear at the moment is seen as a sign that the impact has somehow been benign. And I think the consensus among economists during the campaign was really quite unprecedented. But what was motivating them was the long-term impact here that I think Graham described very effectively at the start of the meeting. So, yes, I mean, the short-term impact is much more uncertain. I think if the Fraser forecast today hold true, then it's still significant. But we certainly shouldn't get hung up on about whether or not we meet the conditions for technical recession over the next year. It's a long-term issues that are really important here. I think on the point about support for business, it's difficult to see any outcome here that's not going to require greater investment in the enterprise networks, I would think. I mean, again, go back to the example of Rules for Origin. RSDI, who I believe currently do a very good job, are they currently properly resourced to be advising companies on things like Rules for Origin? I'm not entirely convinced they are. Why would they be? They've never had to do it up until now, but that is potentially an area for additional investment. I just want to make the point about the lower value of the pound here, making exports more competitive. Now, this has been very widely said, but I mean, I think we shouldn't get complacent about this. I think recent experience, certainly during 2008-2009, showed that we got very little boost from an even bigger devaluation at that point in time. I don't think Scottish exports are particularly sensitive to pricing, perhaps the way they used to be in the past. And again, some exports are, again, the end product of quite lengthy and complex global supply chains, so the import component of that has gone up in price, even as the final product has gone down. And it was just to finish off by saying, I think Graham's made a very good point about looking again at long-standing issues here, and it's an SNP manifesto commitment to implement a national drive to improve productivity. I know I was discussing this with Graham when he was at the Scottish Government, been discussing this with Kenny recently as well, but I think what has happened over the last few weeks should give a whole new impetus to that bit of work.
I, on that particular point, the previous committee looked for clarity in terms of how some of, if we did leave, how some of the structural funds and other support networks would come back to Scotland through the block grant, but we certainly didn't get any clarity on that at that point from the UK government. I take it, you know, if we're going to invest in the extra and the enterprise network and things like that, we need absolute clarity on where the loss of these European funds, how it's going to be made up.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the issues which is a side issue that's involved in all of this is what are the fiscal implications for this? So the potential transfer of new powers to the Scottish Parliament, but the new fiscal framework is quite clear. You either have Barnett or you have the tax raising element. There is no other mechanism through which other funds could come at the moment. But if you take something like cap payments, you know, we have about 8% of the population, but it's something like 18% of cap payments in the UK come to Scotland. So how would that come into the Scottish Parliament budget? It won't come through the tax revenue bit. If it comes through Barnett, then you would get 8% of the equivalent spending in England and Wales. You wouldn't, and that's certainly not 18%. So what is the mechanism that these additional revenues would flow into the Scottish budget? And I think in there's an uncertainty, and that's something which I think is quite important and something which wasn't really thought too much before the referendum. But I think that's quite a significant thing that needs to be resolved relatively quickly about what's the funding implications of potentially the transfer of powers, you know, to the Scottish Parliament, and what obligations would come on the back of that.
Yeah. Well, we have invited UK ministers before the committee, so I'm sure members will be pressing them on that when they do appear. I believe Ross Greer wanted to ask a question next, is that correct?
Yes, apologies. The Fraser Vallander paper mentions the immediate need for fiscal stimulus from the UK government. If we end up in a situation on the other side of the negotiations, we have a less than perfect solution, so something short of single market access, free trade agreement, etc., would you expect in the immediate post-negotiation period for there to be a renewed need for fiscal stimulus at a UK level? Because I'd be concerned about the political willingness for that.
I think there's two things coming back to the point between the short term and the longer term. I think we would see that the negotiation period taking the next 3 years of our forecast horizon. And when we've talked about the fiscal stimulus in that context, we really mean in the short term to almost to make up the potential aggregate demand that will be lost through further uncertainty, etc. I think then what happens at the end of that negotiation period, so 3 years hence, what are the potential long-term, you know, implications for the economy, and whether you need a further fiscal stimulus or whether you need other measures. There's a point where you cannot keep having fiscal stimulus all the time. Yeah, it's just a fact. So I think what we're talking about is a fiscal stimulus in the short term to get you through this period of uncertainty. And then in the longer term, you know, the economy will return to growth. The question is whether it's going to be in the same level of growth as it was in the past, post-EU. So I think the longer term, you're moving less away from having a continued stimulus to actually more is what policies are in place to help promote growth across the economy in a world where you're no longer part of the European Union.
I think, did you have another question, Ross?
Yeah, it was just rather than about the long term, it was more about the specific, the year, 2 years, 3 years, yep, and the immediate post agreement, if we end up with an agreement that is, yep, not ideal. So absolutely recognising that we cannot have continued stimulus, yep, but the potential need for an urgent stimulus if we end up with an agreement that falls far short of what was actually required.
Yeah. So I guess you're talking about the 3 years after the
three years.
I guess really is, you know, it depends on how the negotiations go, and it depends upon what is the end point there. But you know, the economy will do well, and it will, in the sense of adjusting. And I guess the question is whether, you know, the ultimate negotiation is a shock or a surprise. What you're more likely to get, as we talk about in the report, is just a gradual transition as businesses gradually adjust. And if it looks unlikely that you'll have access to the single market, then businesses will adjust, will change their investment plans. Whether you need a stimulus at that particular point, I guess, is, you know, we'll need to see closer to the point in time.
Thank you.
Just a very quick point.
If we are talking about that sort of post-deal period, you know, the other side of the argument, I suppose, is that by that point, neither the Scottish Government nor UK Government were bound by EU procurement rules. So therefore, if they wanted to do a fiscal stimulus, then you can make sure all of that money went to Scottish businesses, indeed Scottish small businesses, to do it. So it might actually have a greater impact. So therefore, you might want to wait until we've left so we can capitalise.
Mike Grumbles. Oh, sorry. Stephen. Yeah.
Careful round about that. I mean, that assumes breaking all ties, I think, with the EU. I mean, I think under any EEA type scenario, there's still going to be very significant constraints. But I think, you know, if it is EEA, such as Norway, under, you know, most sectors, I think Colin will have in mind, then EU procurement rules will start applying.
Okay. Yes. Mike Grumbles.
Could I ask, I'm a bit puzzled by some of the information that's come forward in Graham Roy's briefing paper to us. If I could just talk about outlook and appraisal, my question is about economic growth. It says here, growth over the past 12 months in Scotland was 0.6% compared to 2% across the UK as a whole. And you say that over the past year, Scotland's economic recovery has remained fragile, and last week's 0.0% growth figures for the first quarter of 2016. So if we have completely flatlined and there's been no growth in Scotland in the quarter preceding the European vote, I'm a bit puzzled. Are we not putting too much emphasis then on our forecasts about the impact of the European vote, considering that the statistics that you've just brought before us show that we were in trouble for a whole year before the European vote, and deep trouble with no growth at all this year?
Yeah, I mean, I think I think what we make quite clear in the report is actually that the Scottish economy has been fragile for the last 18 months, particularly since the decline in the in the North Sea, and you'll see some of the charts about some of the particular sectors like that are tied to the supply chain within the North Sea. Some of the manufacturing, sectors, manufacturing is down 5%, over the year, and that's well before the European referendum, where we had 0% growth, as you say, in the first quarter. We also think there'll be challenges in quarter two, actually. Longannet Power Station comes out of the economic figures in Q2. So even if we were to match UK growth in the second quarter of 2016 of 0.6%, we think that just the one factor taking Longannet out could take anything up to 0.4% out of the Scottish figures. So you're likely to have pretty close to zero growth in the first 6 months of 2016. So I guess my point is actually, this is all before you add in the impacts of the European referendum. So we're saying that the economy has been fragile. You're entirely correct. The economy has been fragile. Will the EU referendum have a positive or negative impact on that? Then I think our clear view is that actually, yes, once you add in the these additional effects, then the impact will be negative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I just think it's important to point out, I mean, this, over the last 18 months, the Scottish economy has been fragile. I mean, the main explanatory factor has been the fall in oil price and the impact in the offshore and onshore parts of that industry. But I mean, that was the result of global trends over which neither the Scottish or the UK government can frankly apply much pressure at all. But I mean, this, on top of an already weak economy, we're now potentially self-inflicted major and very long-lasting economic damage. So, I mean, I think there's a kind of contrast there between something that we can do very little to influence, frankly, at Scottish level or UK level, and now, through the referendum, the calling of the referendum and the vote, then we're, in danger of inflicting really serious long-lasting damage.
Mm-hmm. Ronald was keen to come in now.
I had another couple of... Well, one narrow point, and Graham Roy will be aware that in the economic commentary that Fraser Valander published this morning at page 12, there's a reference to one of the reasons for revising downwards the expectations of growth in the Scottish economy over the next 2 years was an expectation that the Brexit decision would reduce sales from Scottish companies to other parts of the UK. That quite surprised me. And Kenny Richmond, in his verbal evidence a few moments ago, talked about the potential for growing the UK market for Scottish products. I think, given that our focus has tended to be on relationships with the rest of Europe, these are interesting aspects, and I'd just be interested in either you would want to comment a little bit further on those points.
I guess we're making around on the exports to the rest of the UK is that by far our largest export market is the rest of the UK. It's 45 billion worth of exports between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So this is a shock not just to Scotland, but a shock to the UK as well. That's why you see in our forecasts, you have a positive shock in the immediate term to our rest of the world exports because of the depreciation in sterling having a boost there. But because we also believe that the UK economy will slow over the next 3 years through the forecast horizon, then that will reduce demand within the rest of the UK for Scottish products. So that has a negative impact on our forecast. So you have that balance between, on the one hand, the depreciation helping rest of the world exports, but also the decision to leave the EU having a negative impact in the UK, which in turn feeds through to Scottish exports to the UK.
I still think there's an opportunity to help companies look for customers in other economies anyway, and look at ways that Scottish businesses can be more efficient, offer better quality services, so they increase their competitiveness. So Graham's right, we may see a slowdown in the rest of the UK economy as well, but there's still opportunities, I think, for Scottish companies to look beyond Scotland for customers.
The other point was a wider one, and I guess around where we are now and where we're going to be over the next 2.5 years, because I think everything that we've heard this morning confirms that the next stage, the stage of negotiation, is going to be absolutely critical. And what the UK government and the Scottish government, as a partner with the UK government in drawing up UK negotiating position, what their priorities should be. On the issue of freedom of movement, clearly closely tied into access to the single market. I was struck when we were in Brussels by one or two of the people we met whose emphasis was not on movement of people, but was on movement of labour. And I wonder, first of all, is that a significant distinction? And secondly, does it offer opportunities for creative negotiation over the next 2.5 years?
I mean, some, you know, the basic points is that, you know, the single market has these four fundamental freedoms, of which freedom of movement is key, and that's integral to the single market holding, because it is linked to freedom movement of labour, but also freedom of establishment. I mean, that's something which is not really picked up usually in terms when you're talking about freedom of movement of people, but it's the freedom of establishment. It's the freedom for someone to go and set up a business in another part of the European Union. And on services, that's the thing that's key. It's the ability for somebody in Germany to come to the UK, set up a service, or vice versa. So freedom of movement is integral to actually the successful operation of the single market. Could you take that element out and still have single market in operation? I guess that's, you know, one of the key questions. I would say I'm quite sceptical of that because of the point about freedom of establishment and freedom of labour becomes quite difficult. But, you know, whether that can be negotiated and whether that could be, you know, agreed is, I guess, is ultimately for part of the process of negotiations with the EU and also the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament's input to these.
Yeah, I think from our point of view, it's the end point that's important, it's the ability to be able to hire the right people when you need them with the right skills, with the minimum of bureaucracy, bearing in mind the particular issues we have in the Scottish economy around about seasonal labour, particularly in the tourism industry. So if you call it something else, or we arrive at some sort of other mechanics of doing it, fairly relaxed about that, if it's possible, and I accept it's, you know, by no means a given. But the bottom line for us has to be that we cannot be going through the sort of hassle that people who, for example, run a Bangladeshi or Indian restaurant at the moment have to go through to get chefs in. We cannot start seeing that for things like fruit picking or you know, housekeeping staff in hotels and all that sort of thing, because simply the system wouldn't work.
Bruce, on the subject of negotiations, in the Spice paper it's produced for the committee, there's a rather counterintuitive issue there. It talks about international trade. And says another reason for declining reliance on the EU market may be the increase in bilateral free trade agreements being negotiated by the European Union, effectively because the European Union has been so effective at building new trade arrangements, our reliance on the European Union has been reduced. I thought of it was counterintuitive, but that brought me back to something Stephen Boyd said earlier, particularly given that we now have, I think there are 50 trade agreements, and we're negotiating now, the European Union is, with United States, America, Japan, India and China, the real big players in the world. And you said something about we've got a level of naivety in terms of how we're going to be able to negotiate in the future. I wonder if you could expand on that. Does that mean that because we've been so integrated into the European Union, that all of the experts from the UK, for instance, who we'd been in that area, are actually now operating in that European arena, and we have nobody here really with that expertise for the future to be able to negotiate separate agreements on behalf of the United Kingdom? Is that where you were coming from? Because if it was, I'd like you to expand it, please.
That's precisely what I was saying. I think much has been written, it's been confirmed by our member unions, I have to say, with members in the civil service, that there is no capacity, and I would stress no capacity, at Westminster for dealing with these complex issues of trade. But I think the issue goes, I mean, a wee bit wider. I think there's just a lack of understanding, as I think I said earlier, about the nature of free trade agreements, the complexity, what they mean, the range of issues they cover. And I think there's probably a lack of understanding also about the importance of the EU's scale in negotiating these and its ability to introduce issues of global importance, certainly for my constituent, issues such as climate change, antitrust. The EU has actually been very active on it. It's been poorly recognised, I think. Tax avoidance, these kind of things, that can introduce into these kind of bilateral discussions in a way that the UK simply would not be able to, because it would just be outgunned by, you know, a, you know, partners which are just simply more economically powerful, but much more experienced in negotiating these kind of complex agreements.
Is that what the rest feel as well?
Just broadening out that point as well, the other thing I would say is that, aside from the expertise issue, is that this is now a unique situation that we're now in. There has never been a situation where someone has, of this scale, size of the UK, has come out of the single market. So actually, even with the best experts in the world, how you actually do all of that process and what the potential implications would be from that is highly significant. So, you know, people talking about immediately joining the EEA as though it's an easy thing to do. Well, one of the reasons why the EEA has worked is because it's a very small number of countries who happen to be very small. You know, you throw in the UK into that mix and that fundamentally changes the makeup of the European economic area. Whether they would want that to happen, whether the EU would want someone like the UK coming into the EEA and still having access to the single market, you know, goodness knows. So within all of that, apart from the point that Stephen makes, which is quite right about the expertise, even if they're the best expertise in the world, the complex problem that we now have to resolve is so significant that it's difficult to see that could be done very, very quickly and not have some quite big issues to resolve.
Just on that point you made, Dr. Roy, about the UK being such a big player entering into the EEA arrangements, are you suggesting in that circumstance that smaller players like Iceland and Norway might be thinking, if the UK is that big a player, them coming into the EEA might disturb the relationship we have and might be resistant?
Well, I guess it's a general point I'm making about I don't know how they would react, but they could react in that way. But the general principle is that it fundamentally changes the balance within the EEA by having a very large member in the United Kingdom versus, you know, small other members, Liechtenstein and places like that. It fundamentally alters the balance. Now, I don't know how the EEA countries would react to that, but it's a fundamental change to the way that they operate, and I'm sure that they would want to think, you know, long and carefully about whether that type of model would be the one that they would be willing to go for.
Thank you very much, and this has been an absolutely fascinating evidence session. We have another panel coming, so unfortunately we're going to have to wind up. But before we do, if I could just ask the panel, we heard yesterday that the European Union had appointed Mark Bernier as the chief negotiator. I wondered if you would care to reflect on that in terms of how likely it is with Mr. Bernier in place that the UK will get its desire to have access to the single market and free movement of people?
I think it's too early to say. It's something I wouldn't be able to comment on.
I think it simply reflects the fact that the EU is likely to play hardball here, but I think anybody who's looked at the issue closely knew that was going to be the case.
Dr. Roy?
I think it's certainly wouldn't like his job, and I just think, you know, it sets the scene for how you know difficult negotiations are going to be over the next wee while.
Yeah, I think it's one of a great many things that you're going to have to reflect on if you're trying to run a business in Scotland during this uncertain period.
Okay, thank you to all our witnesses this morning. Thank you very much, and we will now take a short. Thank you very much. We now move on to the second part of our evidence session, where we'll consider business and sectoral interests. I would like to welcome a new panel of witnesses, Claire Slipper, Parliamentary Officer for the NFU Scotland, Bertie Armstrong, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, David Frost, the Chief Executive of the Scotch Whisky Association, Alistair Sim, Director of University Scotland, Gordon Dewar, Chief Executive of Edinburgh Airports Limited, Hugh Chater, Director of Banking at Virgin Money, and James Withers, Chief Executive of Scotland Food and Drink. You're all very welcome. Now, this is a larger panel than we would normally have, but given some of the issues, the wide range of sectoral issues that's affected by this decision, we felt it was important to hear from as many people as possible. So I would urge members of the panel and witnesses to keep their questions and answers as succinct as possible. I would perhaps just like to open with a general question, and that was what has come across very strongly is the continuing uncertainty for business as a result of the lack of direction or clear direction from the UK government since the vote. I wondered if anybody would care to comment on that and whether they can see an end to this uncertainty anytime soon. Alistair Sim.
I think the important thing is, and I'll come on to talk about universities in more detail in a bit, I think the important thing is that we really get this right. I mean, it's vastly important that whatever future relationship we craft with the European Union is one that maintains the movement of talent and the movement of ideas across boundaries. I think, you know, there is a process that needs to be entrained to set out what our negotiating objectives are that will maintain that as best as possible. For a moment, we rely on the continuing benefits of our continuing membership of the European Union, which is incredibly important for European students and for European researchers. But we do need to be moving into a phase where we can actually start to understand what whether the UK government is setting priorities for a future relationship with the EU that will support our further success.
Gordon Dewar.
Yeah, I mean, we're obviously touch an awful lot of businesses in the sense that aviation is the route to markets or indeed inbound routes for tourism in particular. And I think this uncertainty is a huge barrier. The airlines, by their very nature, are about as transporters as they get. They can put their aircraft wherever they think they'll get the best return. And at the moment, we're seeing remarks from Ryanair, one of the largest, saying they're going to move their future investment away from the UK, at least until it becomes clearer what's going to happen. We've got a UK airline and EasyJet talking about having to set up a business and a new licensing arrangements within the EU to preserve the benefits of open skies. And we've got airlines such as Delta, who've actually cancelled 10 weeks of the winter schedule because of the currency implication, where the winter in particular is an outbound and therefore sterling-denominated business for them, and they don't think that's going to work very well in the depths of winter. Now, all of that's recoverable if we give a clarity about where it's going, because I think fundamentally the economy is strong here, the market's very strong for aviation. But we need things like continued access to Open Skies Europe and continued support and an environment that encourages airlines to invest in Scotland and the UK, where they've got many other choices.
Thanks very much. James Withers.
We were involved in meetings with UK government in London on Tuesday, and to answer your question succinctly, I don't see an end to uncertainty in the very near future. I think there's two things that would be hugely valuable from food and drink industry perspective, one broad and one very specific. The challenge with some of the discussion that there was in London on Tuesday is we're still talking about very, very broad principles. So the benefit of being in the European Economic Area versus a free trade agreement versus being hostage to WTO rules, some kind of sense of what plan A is or option one would be helpful to help narrow down the discussions then on the detail. I appreciate it's a negotiation. There'll be a limit to how much UK government probably want to show their hand, but at least some sense of what an ideal option would be in terms of future relations would be helpful, I think, from our industry perspective, then to start dealing with more of the detail. The one specific area that is of real concern is about the existing workforce. Around about 30% of the workforce in the food and drink industry is from Eastern Europe, and you know, there really is quite an urgent need to get reassurance that those workers who are currently in Scotland working in the food and drink industry, and I imagine across other sectors, will have their rights maintained, because that's causing some real uncertainty at the moment, both for the individual workers but also for businesses.
So in your discussions with the UK government, you weren't able to get those assurances about workers?
No, those assurances haven't been forthcoming. But we made the request that having a clear idea of what, you know, that those options would be in terms of future relationship would be helpful too, but we didn't come away with that. They were very much in the mode of tell us what the negotiating priorities are. So we were able to share that, and they took that away. But I know certainly if you speak to most of the food and drink companies, you wouldn't say they have that assurance on their existing European workforce.
Claire Slipper, thank you.
Thank you. I would support what James has just said there. Obviously, it's early days, and at the moment, we're very much in business as usual mode. You can't turn farming on and off. The longer term priorities are really, really key, and that's exactly what we're trying to voice at the moment. It's important that lines of communication are kept open amongst the Parliament that we've got here, as well as Westminster, and within the wider European agenda. But really what we're looking for now is a confident platform on which to go forward, and that's in terms of the support. Obviously, one of the first negotiations that we'll have is what to do with existing support funds like the CAP, and we're calling for an immediate commitment for that money to be devoted for the next 4 years.
Thank you very much, Bertie Armstrong.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, the Scottish fishing industry has a really very different take on this and regards this as a, to use the phrase, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. There is a systemic change on Brexit, which is the restoration of our exclusive economic zone with regard to fisheries. It is half the northern continental shelf. It is a really, really big patch of prime maritime real estate. And our challenge is in, and I make this quite clear, in political backbone for governments north and south to enact that and not trade it away again. What happened 40 years ago, the best way you can describe it is those who perpetrated it probably didn't really know what was coming next. There were a small number of nations involved in equal access to our seas, turning them over to common grazing. What happened in the interim is 27 countries joined, 28 going on 27 joined, and we now have an unacceptable situation where more than half of the stuff from our EEZ, which we should be the managing partner of, is removed by someone else. The other thing, and there was much talk about bureaucracy in the previous panel, there's a difference between difficult and complicated bureaucracy and a completely unfit for purpose scheme. And the Common Fisheries Policy is, after 40 years invective, you can just Google that, is a completely unfit method of managing fisheries, particularly in our EEZ, where there are 27 nations, half of whom don't fish, participate in the Council of Ministers in the co-decision with 751 MEPs in the European Parliament, 22 of which are on the Fisheries Committee. And overlie on that the Commission's sole right of initiative for legislation and exclusive competence, and you have a completely unfit for purpose scheme. Now we have the opportunity, if there is political backbone, not to trade it away again, of becoming the managing partner in the best piece of the Northeast Atlantic for harvesting seafood. And we could, again, like Norway, who didn't join with us 40 years ago, on a thin majority in a referendum, who didn't join, we could join them or surpass them as world leaders in harvesting, one of the world leaders in harvesting seafood. So there is a gigantic prize for Scotland's coastal communities, Scottish jobs, Scottish economic activity, which in our view must not be traded away. Lots of detail, lots of challenges, but that's the big message and the exhortation to this committee and to Scottish Government and to UK Government as to not sell us down the river again, as happened in 1973.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm sure people will want to come back in on specific points and specific sectors, but I want to give all the panel the chance to just answer that general opening question about their sector. Mr. Frost.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Well, we export into nearly 200 markets globally. We do so over a very long time horizons, decade or more. So we're used to managing uncertainty already in that context. And actually, to be honest, when we look at the situation now, we see a mix of certainty and uncertainty. I don't think it's quite as unclear as everybody necessarily thinks. For us, we can already see that quite a lot of things are going to remain unchanged. We know we're going to have a zero tariff into the European Union for our exports. We know that a lot of external tariffs in third countries are going to remain what they are now, either zero if it's the US, Canada, Mexico, or higher in some of the emerging markets. We're confident we can continue to protect the GI, Scotch whisky, and so on. I think there are two areas of uncertainty and concern. One is around where there are EU free trade agreements that do give us tariff preference, so-called, perhaps 10 or 15% of our exports, countries like South Africa, Colombia, Korea, and so on. Is there going to be any continuity? Can they be grandfathered? Can we continue to benefit from that or not after Brexit? Don't know about that. And I think the other area is the one you touched on in the first session, which is, are we going to have an EEA-type arrangement or an FTA-type arrangement? Are we going to be part of the single market, or are we going to be talking about access to it? That hugely affects the level of whether EU rules in the single market continue to apply in the UK after leaving, or whether we've got to redo all that. And that for us, that's one big level of uncertainty, because all that is largely done at European level at the moment. So there are shapes through the mist, I think, but there is still mist out there.
Thank you, Mr. Shetoff.
Thank you very much. So in terms of uncertainty, I think the first comment to make is that Virgin Money, like probably the majority of UK banks, are much better prepared and kind of set up to deal with a period of economic uncertainty than perhaps in 2007, 2008. Having said that, I think there are three key areas which will determine how the financial sector in particular manages through whatever period of economic downturn we're heading into. And the three areas particularly pertinent to our business are the future of the housing market, both in terms of new build and existing stock. That's, I think, clearly driven by consumer confidence as much as any hard economic facts and indicators. Second area is what happens to the Bank of England base rate. It's clear that whilst many banks, and we're one of them, have got various levers of our business that we can move in response to a change in bank base rate, it will put pressure on the economic performance of banks and other financial institutions. And then clearly the third area is employment, or more specifically unemployment. Those three areas, I think, are kind of emotionally driven as much as driven by hard economic indicators, because at the heart of that is how the individual consumer reacts to and anticipates what's going to happen in the wider economy. And I think to that end, there are certain things that central governments can do to encourage consumers to continue to be confident, and potentially the sooner we start to see some of those levers and policy measures being invoked, the better.
Thank you very much. Before I hand over to Lewis MacDonald, your specific area, Mr. Chater, in financial services, have got specific issues affecting it. Like all services, we've heard how services would not be covered by any kind of free trade agreement, and also so access to the single market is particularly important. We've already heard about financial services organisations looking at locating in countries which have access to the single market. Is that something that you're concerned about or picking up on?
Well, I share the concern about EU employees that we have and their future, I think that's a key issue. I think whether or not the passporting issue, which has been talked about quite a lot for financial institutions in particular, will turn out to be such a key issue as it, I mean, it got a lot of publicity and kind of column inches, so to speak, immediately following the vote. Whether in reality, if that passporting was not available, whether financial institutions would choose to relocate to Europe or to North America, I think is in question. Where I think there may be an opportunity, and this is obviously a kind of political area, so I tread with care, is clearly within Scotland and in Edinburgh in particular, we have a thriving financial services sector that employs, I think, close to 100,000 people. Depending on where Scotland's relationships with the EU land, there may well be an opportunity to offer that as a kind of relocation safe harbour for some institutions that are worried about the removal of passporting from maybe the rest of the UK. But as I say, that's probably an area that I won't say any more about without...
So what you're saying is that if Scotland was able to maintain its access to the single market, then that would give us an advantage.
I do think that's a very credible view, yes.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Lewis MacDonald.
There are a couple of things, very interesting initial contributions, a couple of things I would perhaps want to come back to. And the contrast, I think, between David Frost, who said, well, we're confident that these things will apply, we will continue to have zero tariff with the European Union, we're confident that we'll have similar certainty with some of our major export markets like the United States, but we're uncertain about some of the EU negotiated free trade agreements. On the other hand, Bertie Armstrong essentially saying, I think, that although there's a great opportunity here, there's also a great uncertainty about how fisheries will fare in the negotiations that are going to ensue following the Brexit vote. I wonder if perhaps you could both say a little more. I'm thinking about the evidence we heard in the last session, towards the close of the last evidence session, which was around the lack of experience and expertise within the United Kingdom in trade negotiations. Now, clearly, both Scotch whisky and fisheries are involved in negotiations on a multilateral and bilateral basis on a daily basis as commercial, from a commercial point of view. I wonder if you would reflect on that from your sector point of view, but also how you see it for the process of negotiation that both the UK government and the Scottish government will be involved in the period ahead.
Shall I go first? On the capacity question, I mean, I'm answering with my sort of personal hat on, really, because before I did this job, I was a diplomat, and the last job I did, I was director for trade policy in the Department for Business, and I had 140 people working for me. So it was news to me that the UK government doesn't have capacity in this area. What it doesn't have are people who have spent a long time sitting in trade negotiations as opposed to supervising them, and it lacks some technical expertise, I would say, in sort of things like WTO law, translating deals into texts and so on. So it's definitely going to have to go up a bit. It's definitely going to have to buy some of that in. But the idea that there's no capacity to do or think about trade negotiations is, I think, simply wrong. It exists, and it can be kicked off straight away.
Thank you very much. Yeah, on the point of capacity, yes, we are involved in the coastal states negotiations with not only as part of the EU delegation, but as part of the delegation with other countries. And one of the benefits that will exist is at last we can stop focusing on a bizarrely bureaucratic process and start focusing on outcome, which in our case would be fishing opportunity. That would be no small change and would be a great deal of help in getting rid of that. And I just wanted to re-emphasize the point that the one big thing for us is there is a systemic change here, which most other industries will not come up against. In our case, we would get unleashed. And our fear is that because we are less than 0.5% of GDP, that would be an easy bargaining chip. The Belgian fleet, the Netherlands fleet, the Danish fleet has got very used to catching almost all of their fish in our EEZ over a period of 40 years. They will therefore use that in negotiation, of course, as a matter of observation. And the bit that slightly frightens us is that we've got used to this unusual, pressed, deprived position that we're now in, which we shouldn't be in if we had the managing partner status in our EEZ, and that people will accept that as a continuation of least worst rather than do the best. And I emphasize again, this is Scottish jobs. This is increased economic activity in areas which really need it. And a potential for world leadership. And I don't think that's an overemphasis. There's a whacking great opportunity for Scots fishing here. We would not become the bully of the Northeast continental shelf. We couldn't do that. We would have to negotiate, not with a clean sheet of paper, but from where we stand. But the difference in being managing partner in a beautiful piece of maritime real estate is a very different position than being one of 28 only 14 of which fish, and many of which negotiations have got other things to do. Richard Locke, I'm sad he's not here, because he was a veteran of this and would often claim, why is Austria and Luxembourg and the Czech Republic got a vote in this when they don't even have a coastline? Exactly.
And I know from the Northeast many fishermen voted to leave in the hope that just the scenario you've described would come about. But I think what you're saying is that you recognise that whether that scenario comes about or not will depend on the nature of the remit and the success of the negotiations that go forward from this point.
That's exactly the case.
Can I come back to David Frost on the question of whisky? Because I think you obviously have enormous experience personally, but the Scotch Whisky Association has enormous experience institutionally in negotiating on a global stage. What's your sense of the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead for the wider Scottish economy, as well as and for your own sector? Bertie Armstrong talks about a systemic change for his sector, but for your sector, presumably, it's much more business as usual. But what's your sense of the priorities and perspectives going forward?
Yeah, well, it's a big question. I think for us, I mean, we're unusual, I think, as an industry in that, you know, we export well over 90% of what we produce. So it's what happens in global markets that makes the big difference to us. We also don't have a complex upstream supply chain. You know, basically we take barley and water and yeast and turn it into money is how the system works. You know, we don't have to worry about intermediate goods and complex movements across Europe and so on. So in that sense, we're simple. We can focus on export markets. We can focus on doing stuff well in Scotland. And what makes difference to us globally is getting Scotch whisky onto the market. It's the market access barriers, it's tariffs, it's all the sort of regulation that makes a difference. Now, it certainly makes a difference to us to have, you know, a third of our exports go to the EU. It certainly makes things simple to have one system for the EU to be part of that, as part of the single market, and keeping access to that is really important. But it doesn't change the fact that two-thirds go elsewhere, and keeping up the capacity to knock over market access barriers and get Scotch into those markets is going to be just as important after Brexit as it is now.
And will it be harder?
It will be different because we won't be able to call in to play the European Commission as we do now quite often in specific market access barriers. So we'll have to do more of it ourselves. UK government's going to have to gear up for that. On the other hand, I guess, you know, the UK government's range of interests is going to be narrower. It isn't going to be balancing lots of interests across the whole of Europe, so that might improve greater focus. I think it will be probably a bit challenging in the short run. Looking out to the medium and longer term, I can see how it could be done.
Could I just come in on a supplementary on that particular point? with regards to whisky, because when Oliver Letwin was in front of the Foreign Affairs Select Committee a couple of weeks ago, he was quite specific about admitting that their trade negotiators had moved to the EU and that they didn't have capacity. I don't know if you heard his evidence to the Select Committee.
Yes, I did see what he said. And I think it may be we were talking about slightly different things. I think, as I said, it's true that we don't have people who have actually sat in negotiations on free trade agreements. The way it works is that UK supervises those people through the EU bureaucracy. So in that sense, no, that's done at the Commission. Do we have people who understand the issues? Certainly. Do we have lots of people who've done negotiations? Yes, certainly, in the UK. So I think the intersection of those two things means we've got lots of capacity.
And also, yesterday, Liam Fox was told in the United States that they were not willing to negotiate a trade agreement in advance of the negotiations with the EU. Wouldn't that be a cause for concern for you? I mean, you suggested that you were confident about being able to negotiate something with North America.
Well, no, I think, I mean, I assume the UK government is going to have to get on to negotiating something with the US in due course. It's certainly true that you can't sign any free trade agreements while you're a member of the EU. That's for certain. Can you pick up the process, begin to establish the channels, begin to establish the issues? Well, strictly speaking, no. I think in practice, the Commission's going to have to give some margin for manoeuvre for that to avoid a break afterwards, so it can be done. But I think just one other thing on this. One thing that's really important to us is what happens now. It's not just the big free trade agreements. It's if you have a barrier in Market X now, who talks to that government to get rid of it? At the moment, we've turned to the Commission and the UK government. I think it's realistic to think the Commission might at some point show less enthusiasm on the UK's behalf in that than it does at the moment, and therefore the UK government's going to have to step up quite soon on that, and right. That's probably the more immediate problem.
Okay. Have Bruce
just a supplementary for Mr. Armstrong, because he had a slightly different approach and gigantic prize, once in a lifetime opportunity. It's obviously something, Mr. Armstrong, you've thought a lot about in the industry, and perspective, it's different, and I'm glad we're hearing it today. In that regard then, what preference would your organisation have for the type of trading arrangement that the UK would have in the future?
For us, the most important part would be what status is adopted by the UK. And of course, under the Scotland Act, there's an opportunity for leadership by Scotland here in this, having the bulk of the fishing, as a coastal state. Acting on behalf as the manager of exploitation in its own EEZ. I think that will take care of it. Was there a specific separate direction?
From the evidence that you presented to us, it looked as though you were pointing that an arrangement like Norway would have in part of the EEA might be the best arrangement in future. Yeah. Was that actually what you were suggesting?
Well, I think we stand with the rest in that no choice of that, the EZ, the WTO, at either end of the spectrum or some a hybrid in the middle, remains uncertain. On the point of view of looking at output rather than...
What would your organisation's preference be, is what I was asking.
We continued access to the market, of course, but I note this. That the cod in your fish and chips is likely to be caught in northern Norway, and the prawns in your prawn cocktail are likely to be from the mud of the Mekong Delta. The point being that our market already takes, the European market already takes our imports from elsewhere. There is no reason for us to believe that we wouldn't have access of some sort. Which model it is, whether it is free movement of people and therefore complete access to the free market is yet to be decided. We feel that.
What's your preference, though?
We like everybody else in this panel. We're waiting for an analysis of what the best one would be, or rather, more specifically, what is likely to emerge as plan A, I think.
Okay, well, we heard earlier from others who thought that the least bad option after coming out of European, different perspective from you, accept that, might be the EEA option. Has your organisation looked at what the costs might be for the Scottish fishing fleet of having to bear cost of origin custom rules as part of the EEA, for instance?
That's work that, as you might reasonably expect, is undergoing now. And we were as surprised as anybody else, to be absolutely honest, about the outcome of the referendum. So that work is ongoing now. There will be changes, but we cling to this thought. A market is an exchange of goods bought by people who want to buy them. I was told by a fisherman the other day, the Spanish buy my prawns not because the single market exists, but because they want my prawns. If there is an extra cost in the prawns, which may or may not be offset by a difference in currency exchange, then that market is highly likely to continue to exist, and we shouldn't regard that as an unjumpable hurdle, in my view.
Okay, to be able to get that free movement of people, which I recognise from your submission, is quite an important issue for the fishing industry, and particularly the processing side. That would probably require some sort of EEA arrangement like Norway. In these circumstances, given the fishing interests of the Dutch, the Spanish and Norwegians, why would they, in these circumstances, be prepared to say or welcome with open arms the United Kingdom into that sort of arrangement?
Well, I think the boot, if you like, would be on the other foot. As the managing partner in the sea space that the resource exists, we, if there is the political backbone to do it, would be able to apply pressure to the rest of the market rather than find ourselves impossibly pressed by immovable forces.
What the point I'm trying to make is, why would the Dutch, the Spanish and the Norwegians sign up to any fishing interests, sign up to any deal that the United Kingdom would be in the EEA if it was against their interest to do so?
Well, your second
therefore
guess,
you wouldn't have that free access to people.
You're second guessing the outcome. If indeed there was a crushing blow dealt to the fishing industry in that way, then it would be just that, a crushing blow. But I really don't see that coming. And free movement of people, we should not overemphasize free movement of people. I didn't hear anybody in the run-up referendum debate saying we're going to ban everybody from everything. If it is in the country's best interests to import labor, then for soft fruit picking or for us, I have absolutely no doubt that an arrangement could be reached where that could be achieved. We are continually fighting the governments of the UK asking for more concessions to bring in labour from elsewhere, because it's not immigration, it's used at sea and getting nowhere. So there are many aspects to this, but I don't think any of it's overwhelming.
I'd like to move on. Rachel Hamilton.
Well, it's no surprise that 4 calls for evidence today out of 7 come from the food and drink industry. And I see, you know, from 2007, a turnover of 10 billion and predicted to be 16 billion in 2017. It's a very important part of the Scottish industry. I was wondering if you were working collaboratively in terms of the country of origin and labelling and all the requirements that food need to move forward rather than exclusively on your own, whether it was something that you were looking to work towards to go forward with continued exports.
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that one, Rachel. There's been a lot of work going on really since 2007 in pioneering, I think, what is a world-leading level of collaboration amongst food and drink organisations. We've developed a national identity around our product, this Land of Food and Drink imagery and branding that is now used. So if you're at any international show, whether it's Tokyo, Hong Kong, you'll see a very consistent set of branding from our seafood, salmon, our spirits through beef, lamb, soft fruit, vegetables. So there is a very high level of collaboration going on, both operationally amongst organisations. So we have a strategic board. David Frost sits on that. Claire's chief executive sits on that. The chief execs of many of the trade associations around that table developing a single strategy and a single branding approach. Interestingly, one of the restrictions around being part of the single market is your ability to promote regional foods. To be able to promote Scottish is you can't do that within state aid rules because it's seen as skewing one particular part of the single market. What you can do is promote GIs. So there are about 70 products across the UK that have protected geographical indicator status, same thing that affects champagne and Parma ham. We have 13 products in Scotland that have that. Whiskey has almost a fairly unique level of GI protection through UK legislation, and that provides a greater certainty, I think, for their protection than, for example, Scottish salmon, which is it's Scotland's biggest export. It's UK's number two export, and understanding what the future protection of that status is with Europe and within UK and with third countries will be critical going forward. But in terms of your initial question, a base level of collaboration, we will be ahead of certainly the rest of UK and many countries around the world in working collaboratively to develop that brand. So that gives us a good platform, I think, to negotiate the next few years.
I think I've got Ashton Denham next.
I'm interested in hearing a little bit about the Horizon 2020, which is the EU funding programme for research. Just to put this into context, by March this year, Scotland had secured over €200 million in funding from this programme, with Edinburgh University being particularly successful in benefiting from that. So some early analysis has shown that UK researchers are not being included in planned bids already, and I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit about whether you think there's any evidence that Scotland is already being affected, what the future implications of that might be. And then as a wider question, clearly research also affects businesses, it affects the economy, it has implications for productivity and innovation. So if anybody else would like to come in on that, that would be useful.
Well, thanks so much. I'd like to talk about Horizon 20. If it's all right, I'd also like to just touch on some of the student and staff issues that were facing as a result of the vote, because I think it all really adds up to one picture of how do we sustain a vibrant and internationally open university ecosystem. I don't like to look at these things apart. And just to illustrate the scale of the Europeanness, among other factors, of that ecosystem, I mean, 16% of our academic staff are from the EU. In the last year, for which about figures, £75 million of research project funding came from EU sources, principally Horizon 2020. We've got 24,000 EU students in Scotland spending about £156 million off campus contributing to the economy. Mm-hmm. And we've got about 1,700 students going out each year on Erasmus to European partners. So it's an ecosystem that vitally crosses boundaries. I think that's just intrinsic to the nature of universities. Thinking about Horizon 2020 and related issues, obviously, if you're going to sustain that research ecosystem, one of the crucial things is being able to say to EU staff that you continue to be welcome and that the movement of talent will continue to be possible. I think at least we can say the first of those confidently, and I think the second of those really has to be an absolutely prime negotiating objective for the university sector. As far as Horizon 2020 issues are concerned, I think at the moment, while we remain a member of the European Union, there are problems of international partners' perception more than problems of actual reality. But the perception is a problem in itself if European partners are feeling more uncertain than they potentially need to be. Now, I think it's important there has been a range of statements from the Commission and others that while we remain in the EU, business as usual pertains. Get in there, do your research applications jointly with European partners, still be confident in Horizon 2020. And we've had messages from Commissioner Modus. We've had messages from the League of European Research Universities, European Universities Association, the rectors of 24 European countries saying, yes, we still want you as a research partner because British and Scottish research is excellent. It's a necessary part of a European ecosystem. And very, very helpfully, last week, we put out a joint statement with Scottish Government emphasising this open for business message to try and restore that sort of confidence that's been shaken a bit in the light of the Brexit vote. Longer term, I think, as we look towards negotiating priorities, sustaining that European and international ecosystem, as well as a vital ecosystem across the internal boundaries of the UK, is going to be a really vital negotiating objective, and putting ourselves in as strong a position as we can be, for instance, as Norway is, as a strong participant in European research networks and a voice in Horizon 2020 and its successors. I think there's other issues that we do need to really address quite urgently. It was very helpful that the Scottish Government urgently moved to say that European students currently in the system or joining in 2016 would continue to benefit from Scottish Funding Council places. We need that assurance quickly now in relation to 2017 students, because the prospectus is already out. They were published pre-Brexit vote. They say you can come here and benefit from Scottish Funding Council funding. We want to maintain that for 2017 entrants. There's a contractual element to that offer already being made, and those applications will be coming in the next few weeks. So there's an urgency there in just getting a further assurance out. But in the longer term, really, you know, there are a lot of issues about how do we, what should the status of EU students be in the long term? How do we maintain open to cross-border movement? How do we keep ourselves in European research networks? What happens to regulation, for instance, regulation of intellectual property? Basically the whole package of how, if we're not formally part of the European Union, we maintain a close relationship that sustains a student staff and research ecosystem.
Obviously, for our sector, research and innovation is absolutely key. It's really important to secure the sort of future ongoing vibrance of our industry and developing new techniques there within our farming systems. We already have a fantastic capacity in terms of agricultural research in Scotland, and obviously now there's concerns about future funding for that. But looking longer term, if it depends on the policy direction that the Scottish Government takes. If we are in a situation where we're developing a new agricultural support system, then there's a real prize that we can get there in terms of putting more into really supporting things like practical research, meaningful knowledge transfer, advisory services, and this sort of thing, and have that built in to the support system that we have. And that could be a really tangible goal for the future.
Thank you very much. A very good question, and something that will be very important to us. We have a number of schemes which are indirectly funded by the European Maritime Fisheries Fund. We're still getting reasonably good news. We received yesterday the continuation of the government industry technical advisory group to develop selective gears. So the money is still coming at this point in time. We've not seen that turned away. But we also run 7 observers who contribute to the science. And with the oil industry, via the Fisheries Legacy Trust Company, we run a scheme whereby fishermen are told of where the bottom equipment of the oil industry is, which is no small task. All of this will require alternative funding. So there is a big challenge coming in a number of areas with the loss of indirect funding.
Mike Grumbles. I'd like to ask particularly Claire Slipper of the NFU this issue. I think it's a really huge issue of farm subsidies with the implications for the future. Now, hundreds of millions of pounds are involved here, and I know the NFU want no change for 4 years, but does this not give us a huge opportunity, varying from when New Zealand abolished farm subsidies and made farms more efficient, to designing a system where we can actually subsidise sectors of farming which are not subsidised at the moment, like the pig industry as an example. At the moment, we've got a situation where the funding for farm subsidies is reserved to the UK, but that money will, when we abolish the common, when we leave the EU and we abolish the common agricultural policy, that money will come to the Scottish Government in the block grant. Now, it's entirely up to the Scottish Government what it does with that money. So are we not facing a situation where if the NFU aren't off the ball quickly here, the Scottish Government can be doing all sorts of things with that money? Would it not be a good idea to press the Scottish Government to come up with a homegrown solution for these hundreds of millions of pounds in farm subsidies, rather than just wait and see what happens?
No, you're absolutely right. It's a huge discussion that needs to be had, but also within our membership, and we'll be going out. It's still early days. It's only 5 weeks since we heard the result of the referendum, and of course it's not the result that we expected, but we'll be going out to our members in the latter half of the year to have a wide discussion about where they want to see the future system go, because it's not a time for knee-jerk reactions. I think, as I said previously, there could be a real prize here, as in we could have a system that is much more suited to our needs, that genuinely supports sectors of the industry that need it and helps them to grow and to be profitable for the future. Mm-hmm. One thing that really is key is that this does provide us with a great opportunity to look again at activity and genuinely reward farmers who are farming. Obviously, it's something which we tried to address in round after round of cap negotiations in the past. We've never quite got a robust enough arrangement. Now we can possibly have the opportunity. We do have a dialogue open with the Scottish Government, and we're making them aware of where our thinking currently is, but it needs to be a much more robust discussion with our membership.
It is a tremendous opportunity, is it not? And bear in mind, on the Scottish budget, with all the issues of the health service and everything else, there's going to be a huge amount of pressure on that money, and it's going to be entirely up to the Scottish Government how they spend it.
Well, yeah.
You know, this is an opportunity that shouldn't be missed.
Yeah, this is the concern. Obviously, we don't know if there'll be a nuance of some agricultural funding coming through the block grant and whether or not that money will be ring-fenced, whether or not it'll be topped up by the Scottish Government. It's all to play for, but it's hard to see at the moment exactly where we want things to lie.
Okay.
Because this touches an important point that Dr. Roy made this morning, and I believe the STUC as well, is that the way that the money comes back, the under the new arrangements for Scotland's fiscal settlement, money can only be allocated to Scotland through income tax or the block grant through the Barnett formula, which will remain in place. That's a vow. Now, the point was made this morning is that some of these European payments actually are greater than we would get through the Barnett formula because Scotland gets well above our population share. Now, there has been no discussion at all in terms of how the UK government is going to transfer that money back to Scotland, if at all, and if it does transfer the money back, if it's going to transfer it according to the way it's distributed in Europe, given Scotland a higher percentage than our population. Have you had any assurances from the UK government about how that money's going to come back?
Not as yet, nothing set in concrete, but that's exactly what we're pushing for. As I said in my opening statement, we're looking for them to commit the money that's already been dedicated for the next 4 years, but obviously there's a longer term situation that we need to address here. So it's absolutely what we're pushing with ministers in discussions, but we've not had anything set in stone just
yet. I mean, just from your own sector, for example, Scotland has 85% of the less favoured areas for a start. That's obviously something that would need to be reflected in any new settlement.
Absolutely, and I think what we'll see when the time does come for us to have divergent support policies across the UK, they may look wildly different between Scotland, England and the rest of the devolved nations. The point is that the policy direction will be with Scottish Government. The massive question mark is over the amount of
funding. Sorry to press you on this, but obviously this is way ahead. We're going way ahead in terms of the policy direction of the Scottish Government. You can't have a policy direction if you're not given the money in the first place. Mm-hmm. And certainly this committee pressed UK government ministers in the past, before the Brexit vote, as to how the block grant was going to be readjusted to make up for these monies, and we weren't able to get any reassurances. Mm-hmm. Have you been given any reassurances that we're going to get this money?
I see nothing that's been set in stone just yet, but it's absolutely something that we're pushing with the new Secretary of State.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure we'll push that with the new Secretary of State when we see him. Also, in the same topic, Mr. Withers might be particularly concerned about this. Like the pillar, the Scottish Rural Development Programme, for example, in the Pillar 2 funding, a lot of that funds your sector. I mean, just looking at the figures we've been given from Audit Scotland, for example, is that food processing, marketing, and cooperation gets in Scotland gets 70 million in this particular round. You must be very concerned that that money won't transfer back.
Yeah, it is a concern, but I would also say that what happens in terms of agricultural support is absolutely interlinked with the wider food and drink piece. So that £3 billion Scottish agricultural industry is the bedrock of much of then the £11 billion in manufacturing that happens. I mean, David talked about his raw materials for his industry. A huge amount of their malt and barley requirements are coming from Scotland. So getting that agricultural piece right is absolutely central to Scotland's wider food and drink success. And sometimes we fall into the trap of treating agriculture over here and food and drink wider. So it's important we don't do that. Just to pick up on a point that Mr. Rumbles made in relation to New Zealand, we've got a really good window of opportunity to look at other models here. So New Zealand dramatically changed their support system. I'm not sure they're investing any less in the food and drink industry, but they moved a bit of where that funding went from direct onto farm into their processing and their export position as well. So I think there's a lot of models that can be learned there and how we do that. The advantage potentially of leaving a common agricultural policy, which is not without its flaws, is this real opportunity to create something innovative and new. And that really is a once in a lifetime opportunity. But we need to do some of that work just now. And there are lessons out there. And you know, New Zealand is a very good comparator. Paraphrasing, I suppose, David Frost, who I think was saying that the UK being out of the European negotiating bloc might allow us to be a little bit more fleet of foot and prioritise where we go. The first country on earth to negotiate a free trade agreement with China was New Zealand. You know, population smaller than Scotland. So there's some real lessons for us to learn around all of that, I think, and some research work, which we've started a little bit of just now, on what those other models might be in this current window is going to be really valuable and would be a sound investment. Yeah.
I suppose that, you know, the money has to come to the sector in the first place. You know, like the promise on the bus was that it would all go to the NHS, as I recall. Yeah. Sorry, I think if you've had your turn, I have to speak to get the members in, and I believe that both
supplementary, Kavira, you rightly picked up on the issue which I was going to raise. Can I ask another issue of the aviation industry at this stage? Right. Or do you want me to come back to that?
Cap just now. Well, I'd like to bring in Lewis MacDonald. I think he has a supplementary on this.
Well, it certainly builds on it, but I think I think the issue that's been highlighted in relation to agricultural subsidy also applies to the higher education sector, in the sense that I think Scottish universities punch above their weight in terms of access to European research funding. And I wonder again if that's something that's already on the table in terms of discussions between University of Scotland and equivalent bodies elsewhere in the UK and with the UK and Scottish governments as that, because the same mechanical issues about what would the mechanics be for sustaining that in the event that we're no longer accessing those European funds directly will apply there too.
And I think, as we communicate our priorities and as our partner, UK-wide Universities UK, communicates its priorities, it's very, very clear that because we are universities that are part of vital cross-border ecosystems, that one of the priorities that we're putting into the mix in discussions of the UK's overall negotiating priorities is that we should have as close a relationship as possible with Europe as members of the European research area. And I think there are models, certainly the EFTA countries are close in on that.
I'm interested in hearing a little more about that. So the European research area allows higher education institutions out with the European Union member states to have access to that common market.
That's right. There's various degrees of association. There's associated country status, where countries are really closely involved in the whole Horizon 2020 programme and its successors. And Norway, Iceland, for instance, are really closely involved in that. And really have access that is not that different from that of European Union members. Switzerland, because it stepped away from single market standards of freedom of movement of people, ended up with a status that was one stage removed from that. But as I understand the Swiss status, it's still quite close in. It does give them the capacity to bid into European Research Council funding on the basis of excellent research and the Marie Curie mobility schemes for researchers. So there are models there that we would certainly be encouraging the negotiators to look at about how you can build a relationship with the EU as part of the European research area that levers the maximum possible benefit out of continuing to have a cross-border ecosystem.
So, in a sense, those options you've outlined are parallel to the options that apply for trade. In other words, there's a degree of closeness and engagement on the case of, you mentioned Norway and Iceland, which are countries which have full access to the single market through the European Economic Area, essentially have full access to the European Research Area on the same basis. And Switzerland, again, is one step further away from both.
Yes.
Thanks.
Rachel Hamilton, was that on the same point? Or was
It's just a small point about, we've talked a lot about what the impact of rules, regulations, and the impact of us leaving Europe. But Hugh, you spoke about the three points that very much depend on domestic policy. So you talked about new build, existing stock of houses, you talked about the exchange rate, and the other point was unemployment and or employment. I just wondered if you could slightly expand on how that will affect growth as we go forward.
Yes, certainly. I think if we take maybe the housing market first, clearly, very much driven by supply and demand, but you do have these two factors of new build and potentially government-led new build schemes supporting a very wide and large employer in the construction industry. So I think that is not entirely, but is largely able to be influenced by public monetary stimulus, if necessary. And clearly, there are a lot of jobs associated with that, which, as members will recall, in the last recession, 2007-2008, when it started, the construction industry was very badly hit. And a lot of those skilled jobs were lost, in inverted commas, forever. And I think we will find that a lot of a similar thing will happen in the event that the UK government decides, for instance, to pull away from its target of 300,000 new homes to be built. So I think that's one part of the sector that's important, and clearly a percentage of those will be earmarked, in inverted commas, for Scotland. I think there's also a very human dimension associated with the housing market, which is we are still a country, the UK is still a country where the ambition to own your own home is a very pervasive ambition, and it's an aspiration that a huge number of people living in Scotland or the rest of the UK have. And a lot of the government schemes that have been introduced recently, and I know have had particular Scottish flavours to them associated with Help to Buy and also Help to Save for your home, I think they need to be protected and potentially considered to be expanded so that the people who live and work in Scotland and the rest of the UK can feel as if they can continue to have that aspiration, and that houses are provided as part of this construction of new build, which are suitable for starter homes and for people to own, to get there and get themselves on the housing ladder. Clearly, all of that depends on employment and continued employment. And the point I was simply trying to make is that a degree of employment can, of course, be driven by fiscal policy and monetary policy. Good old Keynesian economics can potentially have a role to play in here. So, we've seen a good degree of QE happening in the recent past. Maybe potentially within Scotland, we need some more direct investment in major infrastructure projects. Clearly, we have a number on the go at the moment, the second crossing, etc. In the rest of the UK, there's a lot of talk about High Speed 2, the rail link, which clearly doesn't directly impact north of the border. But I think we have to be very aware of the fact that at the heart of the economy, we need consumers to be confident in their ability to have sustainable employment and sustainable income. to support the local demand for the kind of products and services that we were talking about over here. Of course, the export and the opportunity to re-enter markets that we might be part of now, or to enter other markets that we might be part of as within our membership of the EU, of course that's critical. But at the end of the day, we also need to pay a lot of attention to, as I've just said, local employment, local consumer confidence, and local demand. And then finally, I guess the point about bank base rate and why that's important is that I think there are two potential implications here. Without going into hopefully too much detail, essentially what can happen when interest rates reduce is that the margin that financial institutions make between what they lend at and what they pay interest on their savings can get compressed. That can reduce their appetite for lending. And as we've seen in previous recessions, in the event that were to happen, the economy grinds to a halt, to use a kind of emotional phrase, very, very quickly, because whether we're talking about, corporate small businesses or, retail banking in the kind of banking that Virgin Money does, credit is the lubricant that keeps the system flowing. So I think paying particular attention to that and to ensure that the messages we've heard from the Bank of England and from the Chancellor generally about ensuring that doesn't happen, making sure that the Scottish Government presses that home and ensures that the lessons of previous recessions, albeit caused by different circumstances to this one, which I think is very much an economic set of circumstances caused by a political issue, but nevertheless, that fundamental principle of the need to ensure that there is a ready supply of lending within the system for businesses and consumers is fundamentally vital and is something that needs to be considered and addressed both, within Scotland and more generally within the UK.
Does that answer your question? Thank you very much. Yeah. Ashton Denham.
Thank you. I'd like to turn now to aviation. So this is a question for Mr. Dewar. Changes, to aviation, how it operates, can clearly have quite a big impact on Scotland. Obviously, it can affect tourism. It can affect the economy. We know that, transport and air routes are quite important for foreign direct investment and so on. The International Air Transport Association has put forward what it sees as a sort of three options available for aviation cooperation. So the first one they mentioned was continued access to the single aviation market. The second one was a type of bilateral agreement. And the third one would be that there would be no formal agreement. Would you be able to give your view on which of those options you favour and why?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's absolutely critical that we preserve our access to the open skies policy. It's been deeply ironic if we lost it, given the UK was actually with the founding concept of that and has been pushing that for many years. And of course, we're an island nation in the northwest periphery of Europe, so that air access is more important to us than any other European country, simply because we don't have the land-based options. So I think it's absolutely crucial we do that, and the implications of not achieving that are really very severe. We've already seen EasyJet thinking about having to relicense themselves in Europe to preserve that. One of the largest, if not the largest, second largest, in Europe in terms of thinking about relocating outside the UK, and inevitably losing some focus on the UK market would be very severe. And I think aviation is a really good barometer. Aviation touches everything, whether it's access to markets, whether it's our biggest employer being inbound tourism. All of these things, we've got a real opportunity to be there, and it's one of the most visible as well, because it touches individuals' lives as well as governments' lives. So the good news is things we do in aviation also tend to have a very fast return, and we're talking an awful lot this morning about waiting to see, negotiating over months or even years to see what an outcome is. We can actually do one thing that's really quick and very demonstrably internationalist, which is just follow the existing government policy and half APD. Now, it's a very low-cost impact, but in terms of reversing what we're already seeing from the airlines talking about moving their investment away from the UK, it would fundamentally reverse that and would see very significant growth almost overnight, which could be benefiting the economy and jobs in 17, never mind, you know, 20s and 40s that we're talking about going forward. So I think if we wanted to stand out as being internationalist, open for business, still welcoming, if it's a tourism business or indeed looking at the education or any other sector, as to want to preserve and grow these links. And remember, just we are that very northwest periphery and aviation is so crucial. Following through quickly, announcing something on having the APD and delivering that in early 18 would have a very profound effect, both in terms of the economic benefit directly, but the signal it gives, not just to airlines, but to every other business in Europe.
Can I follow up on the question of open skies you mentioned? The current setup, again, is slightly parallel, I guess, to the European research area. There is a European Common Aviation Area which extends beyond the member states. How does that operate for countries that are out with the European Union at the moment, and how easy would it be for to enter it or to remain in it as a non-EU member?
I don't know is the honest answer. It's inevitably going to be part of the political bargaining that goes on. And, you know, and we hear concerns about fisheries, and I don't think any industry is immune from being part of that political bargaining that's going on. But I think, you know, we've got to put the priorities out there and say what's important. If you look around the patch, within Europe, I think it's highly unlikely we'd lose significant access, although there may be issues around where you hold your license in terms of an airport operation. So I'm not massively concerned about that. But you don't need to look too far where, for example, Norwegian Air, which has got full access into the European market, is not getting full access to the American Open Skies Agreement that the EU has with America. So it's conceivable that you see these little wrinkles around the edges or indeed lack of progress with future connectivity. You know, China being an obvious area where there's huge growth in connectivity. At the moment, the UK is doing very well out of that connectivity. But if for whatever reason China decided it'd be more sensible to focus its bilateral with the remaining EU and not the UK, even in terms of timing, if not intent, that would have very significant issues, I think.
So this is parallel in a way to trade, in a sense, because presumably what then happens is that Norway has to negotiate directly with the United States in terms of future arrangements.
So that's correct.
It's possible to be in the European Common Aviation Area, but still to have to engage in these additional
negotiations.
On the same point, we heard this morning that countries within the EFTA EEA area aren't part of the customs union, and I note from your briefing that you talk about without a formal agreement of potential of, you know, much more customs operations at airports. That's going to have a big impact. If that happened, it would have a big impact on your business, and also I would have thought on things like tourism as well.
I think that's inevitable, yeah. I mean, if we're talking about having different tariff structures and different allowances and so on, it's going to certainly, if nothing else, complicate things. It's not necessarily all bad news. I mean, there are opportunities in there as well in terms of going back to true duty-free trading and so on, which we currently have with non-EU countries. So there are ups and downs within that, but again, it's about the uncertainty. It's about being really clear that we hope to have the widest possible access and continued growth in that. And I can't emphasise enough just how important aviation is when you're an island state. And, you know, again, one of the opportunities with tourism in particular is we must make it easy and understandable for people to come here. They do have choices if you're a German tourist as to where you're going to fly. It's very easy to go left instead of right. We need them to be looking to Scotland as somewhere they want to come, both emotionally and indeed practically in terms of making it possible.
Ross Creer, I think you had a supplementary on this topic.
It's not on this topic.
All right, it's a new one.
Yeah.
Right. Did anyone else want to ask about aviation?
What's the point of clarity? Because I'm trying to understand some of this. I recognise the challenge, obviously, Mr. Dewar, around the Open Skies Agreement and the real danger that if the UK is no longer in the EU, we may have to separately do another negotiation with the USA. The European Common Aviation Area, though, we wouldn't automatically be part of that either, I assume, in the circumstances we're about to enter into. Does each country within that European Common Aviation Area require to agree the other country being part of it?
It's negotiated at the European level, so you'd have one negotiation, but inevitably there's obviously all of the other countries would be influencing the decision and the outcome.
Yeah, but if Iceland Norway and Switzerland are part of that. We must have agreement from them as well to be part of that. So it's not just a straight matter, I don't think, of having an agreement with the European Union. Mm. We'd also have the agreement from Iceland, Norway and Switzerland. Would you be right in saying that?
You're going beyond my own competency in terms of how they're going to decide that. But inevitably, there'll be one negotiation. Who has influence in terms of what the outcome is says that obviously anybody within that on the other side of the negotiation will have a say in some shape or form.
Well.
Thanks. The Maastricht Treaty obviously conferred, and the ensuing European citizenship conferred benefits for those who are not economically active in terms of freedom of movement. Looking at the UK's negotiations with the EU in terms of access to single market and the implications in terms of freedom of movement, do your sectors have any particular opinions on the distinction between freedom of movement for all persons and freedom of labour, i.e. the economically active?
I'll just say from the university perspective, it would be important that the dependents of EU staff are able to come here as well as the EU staff.
Anyone else?
One comment. I mean, I certainly share from our point of view the concerns about labour from other EU countries. I mean, it's not as big an issue for us, probably, as some others around the table, but it's definitely there as part of it. I think, you know, to the extent that our membership are large multinational companies, they also have a concern about, you know, the ability to move, I suppose, relatively highly paid staff around Europe easily as part of how you run companies like that. Would potentially come into question as part of this. I think the only other remark I make maybe is a bit of a wider one, that sometimes I think these things are interpreted too pure in too purist a way. Yes, it's true that there's full free movement of persons across the EU, but you still have to be qualified to do the job. You can't move to some other European countries and expect work, for example, as a plumber or an electrician, let alone a lawyer or whatever. So the principle is one thing. In practice, it's much more complicated than that. And I think when we get into this discussion as UK and EU, that reality as well as the principle is going to have to be part of the discussion.
Thanks very much. Now, we're coming to the end. Ms. McDonald's on the same topic.
It's a broader topic, actually, and perhaps something that would be helpful to the witnesses to consider. One of the things that's clear going forward is that the UK government has invited the Scottish government to be a participant in drawing up the terms of negotiation in approaching the exit negotiations. And I think it would be useful to the committee to understand if there are conversations going on from the different sectors around the table with the UK government, with the Scottish government, and specifically if there are, I think Claire Slipper and one or two other people have referred to being asked what the priorities are in negotiations going forward. Are there issues at this early stage which would be useful for the committee to be aware of in relation to the negotiating priorities that different sectors have and that both governments are consulting you on? And are both governments consulting? I suppose that's the other important question.
So I think from our point of view, we have been really quite quick off the mark, I like to think, in getting in and talking to both governments quite quickly and feeding into priorities. I mean, to be honest, I think we've probably been a bit quicker than certainly the UK government itself in getting itself in order and putting messages in. It's maybe a bit different here in Scotland, where the First Minister got in on things quite quickly. So I think it's probably too early. I mean, the system's kind of gearing up. There'll be a sort of committee structure. There are two new ministries to develop and so on. And I think we're just repeating some simple messages, I guess, about us to as many people as we can, and that will get into the process as we go forward. I myself, obviously, I'm on the First Minister's Advisory Council on a personal basis on all of this, so I guess that will be a forum to think about some of this, but it's not at that point yet.
We immediately got involved with discussions with Scottish Government. Fergus Ewing, as the Fisheries Minister, was straight out of the stall with us immediately after the vote, and that is really, really useful. And he's sequentially seeing every sub-association, so he understands the sectoral differences as well. So that's in as much as that's information gathering, that's going very well. I am perceiving that the UK government is still setting up its infrastructure, and therefore, whereas we've made the requests and we've had rather meaningless exchanges of we'll all do as best we can, there hasn't been much substance overall, and we're very much looking forward to that. And there may come a day when we ask Scottish Government for assistance in this matter if we feel it isn't going well, but it's very early days, and the infrastructure simply isn't there yet.
Alistair Sim, I think you...
Yeah, I think we have had initially pretty good engagement with the Scottish Government. I think, as I said earlier, they moved quickly to give the necessary assurances to current and 2016 joiner EU students. We're working with them on what assurances can be given to people applying for 2017 entry, and it was very useful to get a statement, a confidence-building statement, jointly out with Ms. Somerville on research. In relation to the UK government, we are working very closely with our partner organisation, Universities UK, which obviously has had discussions with the relevant portfolio ministers. But as others have said, clearly the negotiating position of the UK government is still very much being formed.
Does anyone else want to?
Could I just, very last intervention, convener. One thing that slightly worries us is that in the terms of reference of the group, for instance, that Hugh is part of, David is part of, the thrust is how do we best stay as close as possible to the EU? There is at least one sector that would wish, under whatever circumstances prevail, to have a very careful look at how we defend our position outside the EU. That's rather starkly stating it, but it's there's one area where it's in Scotland's strongest interests to not have the closest relationship in that respect. So that's just an area of worry that we'd wish to we'd wish to flag up, and of course we'll be talking to you about that.
Yeah, we've certainly been able to air that particular position today through the committee. So I think we'll finish up now. Thank you very much. We're all to time. Thank you very much to all our witnesses for coming along. I very much appreciate your time today. And we'll now go into private session.